We just need to know which.
Hello.
Okay, welcome everyone to this seminar with Tayyab Safdar on the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, Progress, Opportunities, and Perils. Tayyab is a postdoctoral researcher at the Center of Development Studies at the University of Cambridge, where he completed his PhD on the effects of economic globalization on agro-industrial value chains in developing countries. And his current research explores the economic and political dimensions of increasing Chinese investment in host countries that are part of the Belt Road Initiative. And before joining the Center of Development Studies, Tayyab was an LSE fellow at the Department for International Development. Tayyab will speak for about 45 or so minutes, and then we'll have time for questions from the floor, as usual. Okay.
Thank you very much, Fezi. This is on? Yeah. So thank you. It's a pleasure being here. So as is, this is my first talk over here. I've been here multiple times before, but this is the first time that I've had the opportunity to speak at SOAS. And the Belt and Road Initiative is a fascinating, you know, area to study. Where does one begin? Where does one end? That's always a question. And it's an evolutionary, you know, sort of a project. As things move, as more and more countries join in, the evolution of the Belt and Road Initiative continues, and CPEC very much is at the heart of this evolution. CPEC, you know, is called the pilot project of the Belt and Road Initiative. What does it mean to be the pilot project of the Belt and Road Initiative? And that's something that I'm going to look at in deeper detail, you know, as the talk goes on. Just to talk about the methodology, so I've been in Pakistan for the last 9-10 months doing field work. And primarily what I've done is that I've informed this research through more than 70 in-depth interviews with policymakers in Pakistan especially, but also Chinese policymakers as well, with businessmen, with you know, as many people as I could get hold of. You know, and then I've also analyzed a lot of government documents as well. A lot of these documents are unpublished. They're not available in the public's affair, but I've been able to get hold of them. Interestingly enough, while the success of the BRI is not contingent on CPEC being successful, but because of this whole discourse about CPEC being the pilot project of the BRI, whatever happens in the BRI is important for Beijing. It's important for Pakistan, of course, because this is a huge chance. You know, you've got so much money coming into the country. However, it's extremely important for Beijing to ensure that the optics work. So even if, you know, things aren't moving as smoothly as they say, the optics have to work, because there's a lot of people, there are a lot of people who are actually watching it, not only in Washington, in London, etc., but also in many of the other countries that are a part of the Belt and Road Initiative. So the way that I've structured this talk is that I'll talk briefly about what the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor is. Next, I'll look at two sectors in particular. Those are energy and transport. These are the two sectors where a lot of the initial money has gone. What sort of progress has been made in these sectors is important, but also, you know, where the snags are and what sort of problems have arisen are also important. And finally, I look at industrial cooperation. That's a nascent, you know, sort of an area. However, industrial cooperation, trying to understand where they're going with CPEC, is extremely important as well. At its heart, for people who don't know, CPEC is a connectivity project, right? So it's basically from Kashgar, which is in Xinjiang province in China, all the way through Pakistan. You go down to Balochistan and you connect Gwadar with Xinjiang. So what that does is that it reduces the transport time from Western China all the way to the sea. And it solves a number of other problems as well. But it is much more than that, as when you talk to, you know, policymakers in Pakistan. So Pakistani policymakers actually call it a game changer. And the language that they use is extremely interesting, because what they say is that they want to move from taking advantage of Pakistan's geostrategic position to a geoeconomic position. So what does a geoeconomic position, you know, sort of mean? And when you ask them, you know, there's not a lot of response about what geoeconomic actually means. But there are critiques as well. Within the Pakistani policymaking, there is criticism in the way that CPEC has evolved. For example, one of the bureaucrats that I talked to said CPEC has become transactional, moving from project to project as opposed to programmatic. So rather than, you know, sort of vision of how things should be, it's become more about, you know, project to project sort of interaction between the Chinese and Pakistanis. And it's been developed and actually been implemented by bureaucrats on both sides. And there's emergent literature as well. So McCartney in a 2019 paper actually asked, can CPEC be a leading sector of the economy? So can it pull the economy along with it as well? In the sense that Rostow, you know, sort of in the stages of development actually used. McCartney is not very hopeful. He says that the elite in Pakistan have had these chances before as well, and they've not been able to actually have a consensus on where they want the society to actually move. And a recent book, Wolf 2020, is actually scathing in the way that it views the CPEC. So for Wolf, CPEC actually reduces economic freedom, is geopolitical as opposed to primarily economic, gives rise to corruption, it's a debt trap, loss of political sovereignty, challenge to the rule-based liberal international order. And that's something that you hear about in the policy world about, you know, the Belt and Road Initiative, that it's a challenge to the liberal international order, and China is going to trying to reinvent the way that the international rule-based system works. CPEC, as I said, you know, it occupies this special position as far as the Belt and Road Initiative is concerned, and the Chinese foreign minister had an interesting statement. So if the One Belt, One Road is like a symphony involving and benefiting every country, then construction of the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor is the sweet melody of the symphony's first movement. So that shows you the importance at the highest level that CPEC was given. Of course, this is a little dated. This statement was from 2016. A politician from the opposition Pakistan People's Party that I talked to said CPEC is the jewel in BRI's crown and Gawadar is the jewel in CPEC's crown. So that sort of gives you an idea of how policymakers and politicians on both sides of the divide actually look at CPEC. And it's seen as the country's top priority across the board. You know, whichever event you go to in Islamabad, the first thing that you hear is that CPEC is above political divide. Everyone in Pakistan supports CPEC fully. And of course, the reality is more nuanced than that, but we can discuss that during questions. And as I said, you know, the stakes are quite substantial for China. So as I said, you know, the optics are extremely important. But what does it mean to be the pilot project of the BRI? And that's something that we'll unpack. It's the only bilateral corridor. So there are five constituent corridors in the Belt and Road Initiative. CPEC till 2018 was the only bilateral corridor. So that was the only, all other corridors actually had more than two countries involved. So for example, the Russia-China-Mongolia corridor has three countries involved. What that means, in theory at least, is that the cost of coordination for you is easier, right? So you have lower cost of coordination, which means that it's easier for you to actually negotiate with one country alone as compared to with multiple countries. The China-Myanmar Economic Corridor, President Xi Jinping was in Myanmar recently, is the other bilateral corridor, but that came much later. So that was announced in 2018, even though negotiations were ongoing since 2017. And of course, there's this whole notion of China and Pakistan as all-weather strategic friends, iron brothers. So in Pakistan, they say that Pak-Chin Dosti is higher than the Himalayas and deeper than the Indian Ocean. So that's the sort of discourse around China-Pakistan relations. And in most of these other corridors, because there are multiple countries involved, there's tension between countries, who are constituent members of these corridors, or there's historically been conflict between China and these countries as well. That is completely missing as far as the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor is concerned. And a lot of people actually don't appreciate that. However, the cooperation between the two countries has been institutionalized. So, for example, by 2013, when interaction actually started or when discussions around CPEC started, there was an institutional mechanism that was developed for interaction between the two countries. So right at the top is the Joint Coordination Committee. The Joint Coordination Committee meets once a year, and it is jointly chaired by the Minister of Planning, Development and Reform of Pakistan and the vice chairman of the NDRC, the National Development and Reform Commission. The agenda is set by a number of joint working groups, and these are the areas where, you know, there's cooperation between the two countries, or there's institutionalized cooperation between the two countries. The red ones show the new areas of the joint working groups that have just been started. So after the change of government, there's been a reorientation in the way that the government wants to take this forward, or would like to take this forward. And these are the three areas where there are new joint working groups that have actually been set up. So these working groups actually set the agenda for the Joint Coordination Committee. Projects are deliberated on and discussed at the level of the joint working groups, and they then go to the Joint Coordination Committee for approval and for further deliberation. Again, this sort of institutionalized cooperation is missing in many other cases. So it's interesting that right at the start you had this sort of an institutionalized cooperation. And the speed of project implementation. So Pakistan is one of those few countries where you had a lot of projects ready, right? So there were lots of PC1s, as they say in Pakistan's planning parlance, ready. They didn't have resources. So in comes China, which had the resources to actually, you know, do a lot of these projects. And if you look at the construction projects, the amount of money that's gone into these construction projects in the last 5 years, it's around $50 billion. To put that into perspective, the next country in line is Malaysia, and the resources given or resources promised to Malaysia are $38 billion. So that's just the speed of progress as far as the China-Pakistan economic corridor is concerned. And it's equivalent to around 6.5% of the total spending on the BRI, which again, in terms of money going to a single country, is the most money that's gone to one country alone. And there are the economic relations between both the countries are expanding. So on the right-hand axis, you've got foreign investment from China. And on the left, you've got the total foreign direct investment that's coming into the country. So notice that from 2013 onwards, China actually accounts for almost 70-75% of FDI into the country. The green line is actually Hong Kong. So I added both China as well as Hong Kong because a lot of investment actually flows through Hong Kong as well, a lot of FDI from China by Chinese SOEs. So that just gives you an idea of how economic relations between the two countries have been expanding, especially since CPEC's announcement. And at the end of the day, as I said, there's a lot of strong popular support for the Chinese in Pakistan. So you go on the street, you ask the average Joe about America, you'll get, you know, this whole tirade against, you know, the US and how it's enemy number one. But you ask the average Joe about China and say, oh, you know, China and Pakistan are best friends. And it was interesting that one of the statements that I heard, Chinese have a very favorable impression in society and they're welcomed by ordinary people. The response that they get in Pakistan is probably unmatched anywhere else in the world. And that's also corroborated by looking at, there's a new publication by the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences, which looks at the risk profile of various countries where foreign investment is being made by Chinese enterprises. So one of the variables that they look at is Chinese relations. And over there, the country with the most favorable relations as far as relations with China are concerned is Pakistan. The index is based on six sub-variables. You know, it's got investment block and then, you know, a number of bilateral investment treaties, et cetera, on that. But that just gives you a notion of how, you know, it's despite the fact that there are the other risks are quite substantial in Pakistan, the fact that it has best relations with China matters. Now, the implementation of the project was supposed to be in phases, right? So you had an early harvest phase, which was 2015 to 2020, medium-term phase, and then a long-term phase. So in the medium-term, the idea was that you would have initially cooperation as far as dealing with the structural problems, supply-side problems were concerned, in transport and in the energy sector, and then you would slowly enhance cooperation into other sectors of the economy, such as industry, etc. And in the long-run phase, you were basically connect Xinjiang to the port. So that's the idea behind it. As I said, the early harvest phase, two sectors are most important, which I'm going to talk about, energy and transport. So why energy? Pakistan has had serious problems as far as access to energy is concerned, electricity is concerned. In 2012, for example, when the Pakistan People's Party was in government, you had a maximum shortfall of 5,000 megawatts. In the premier countries or in the main cities of Karachi and Lahore, you had load shedding of around 12 odd hours a day. GDP reduced by 2 to 2.5%. This is these are figures of the Asian Development Bank. And you had high transmission and distribution losses as well because the system just could not cope with the lack of investment that had been made. And this was despite the fact that you had generous incentives that were given to producers to actually, you know, sort of invest in generation. A background of the power sector. So the power sector in Pakistan, you know, you had reforms in 1994. The World Bank sponsored a lot of these reforms, whereby you privatized, so you had a vertically integrated entity called WAPTA. So basically, the World Bank broke it into various pieces, and there were subsequent reforms in 1994, 98, 2002, etc. The total generation capacity of the country, so most of the money actually went into generation. So a lot of the private money that came into the country, both foreign investment as well as local investment, went into the generation node. So if you think of electricity as a value chain, it's the generation node where a lot of the investment went. And around 2014, 40% of total generation capacity was in the private sector. And a lot of it was based on oil and later gas. And so 64% of your total generation came from thermal sources. So that was the situation in 2014. So when Pakistan and China started discussing about the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, Nawaz Sharif's government came in 2013. And before that as well, there were discussions ongoing about, you know, sort of dealing with some of these supply-side bottlenecks, because one of the things that people saw was, or policymakers thought was, that the real issue with growth was that you just did not have enough sustainable power available for the, in the grid for people to actually invest in industry, etc. And the Pakistani government actually observed, Pakistan looks towards Chinese friends to extend their cooperation in developing coal, hydropower, and transmission lines. It was seen as a way to deal with some of the fiscal constraints. So Pakistan was fiscally constrained. 2013, you had the IMF program ongoing in Pakistan as well. So the state did not have a lot of capacity to actually invest in generation. And across the board within Pakistan's sort of institutional architecture, there's this belief that the private sector should take the way forward as far as the power sector is concerned. So in 2014, both sides agreed that in the initial phase, we will invest on the basis of imported fuel. So instead of dealing or instead of exploiting local sources of energy, what we're going to do is that we're going to use imported sources of fuel to actually get generation going. And then, you know, slowly we can develop the local sources of energy. And in the medium to long term, you know, you had local sources, especially to reduce this dependence on imported fuel. There was also this idea that the transmission and distribution system was weak, so therefore there has to be investment in the transmission and distribution system as well. And that's where the bulk of the investment has gone. So 70% of total financing in this first phase of CPEC has gone towards the power sector. And when you look at it in the context of the Belt and Road Initiative, 38% of the total investment during these years, these initial 5 years, this is till 2018, has gone towards the power sector. And there was a lot of criticism about how, you know, the Chinese investors are actually given higher returns. However, policymakers say, look, you know, there's no bar on anyone coming into the country and investing in the power sector. No one wanted to come in. Local investors actually did not want to come in and invest in the power sector. And it was only the Chinese who showed interest. So basically, you know, we had no choice. And it was decided early on, as I said, the independent power producer mode of generation was well entrenched. So you had, since 1994, you had independent power producers in the economy. So this wasn't something which was a new, sort of addition to the system. There were other things as well. For example, circular debt is a persistent problem. Circular debt basically means that your cost of generation is high. Your cost of generation, distribution, and transmission is high. And you just don't get enough money in terms of the payments that you're receiving from people, which means that the state has to subsidize X amounts of rupees in order to keep the system going. And because the state does not have money, basically that debt keeps on going and going up further. And then there were other, you know, sort of ideas as well. This is very interesting because they wanted to use Chinese standards in designing these energy projects. So one of the things that the Chinese have been trying to do is to emerge as trendsetters or as setters of standards, because they want to emerge as, you know, a knowledge economy. And that's something that they wanted to do, and they've explicitly mentioned that during the negotiations as well. So under 2000, these investments have been governed by the 2015 power policy. And what that power policy actually says is that basically you've got no risk. In theory, you've got no risk as an investor. Your return on equity is guaranteed by the government of Pakistan. Everything is indexed to the US dollar in case that it is, foreign component. Import duties are lower in case that you don't manufacture anything. And in case of Pakistan, coal is a new technology. So basically there was no manufacturing capacity at all. So everything had to be imported. The government ensured that you had convertibility from the US dollar, from Pakistani rupees to US dollar. In case that you weren't paid, as I said, you know, circular debt was a problem. So in case that you weren't paid, the government actually said, we'll give you money for delayed payments as well. So that the rate is the Karachi interbank rate plus 2%. And in case that you're not able to meet your fuel supply as well, the government bore that risk as well. So this is quite a sweet deal that the Chinese investors got. And of course, so once you had these sort of guarantees, there's been substantial progress. So in the last 5 years, you have added 5,000 odd megawatt of capacity, which is a total investment of around $9 billion. This is only in generation. There are other nodes where there has been some investment as well. And while much of this initial investment went towards imported coal, there's also been moves to develop local sources of fuel as well, for example, Heidel and Thercoal. And these investments have played an important role in alleviating some of these problems. So for example, now, even in rural areas, load shedding is quite limited. In the major cities, you've got no power shortages at all. And policymakers point out that this is actually foreign direct investment. So what that means is that there is no debt implication for the Pakistani government. But the truth is, of course, more nuanced than that, and we can discuss that further as well. So if you look at the total capacity, some of this capacity in 2018 is apart from CPEC as well, but total capacity actually went up at around 13,000 megawatt. And if you look at the total generation, which is on the right side, my left actually, it's gone up quite substantially as well. And the total share of CPEC investments in the national transmission system is around 14.5% of total generation. And interestingly enough, this is only two power plants at the moment. So there are only two power plants in 2018-19 which were CPEC-related power plants. So that's a total capacity of around 3,500 megawatt. The Pakistan Muslim League also, invested in other areas as well. So this is the Sahiwal coal power plant. This coal power plant is 1320 megawatt. This was built in 22 months. And 22 months for a 1320 megawatt power plant is unheard of. So they actually started calling this Punjab speed rather than Chinese speed. It's completely, so even the chandeliers came from China. And you just cannot build a 1320 megawatt power plant in Pakistan in 22 months by having local, doing local sourcing as well, and talk about that further. There's also been a recalibration of priorities. For example, one of the things is that the Chinese want something and they'll push you to doing it. However, there's been an ongoing dialogue process between the two countries. As I said, the dialogue process between the two countries has been institutionalized. So there's a constant, recalibration of priorities in the power sector. If you look at the early harvest projects in the power sector, some of them were dropped, others were added through mutual discussion. And of course, there's a lot of lobbying involved as well. And lobbying not only by Chinese state-owned enterprises, but also by Pakistani conglomerates who are partnering with Chinese firms. And there's been a joint study in the power sector. So in 2018, there's a joint study that was undertaken by both governments. And what was decided out of that study was that we have enough capacity in the pipeline to actually now stop investing in the power sector. Because if we invest more in the power sector, there's going to be a bubble that's going to emerge, and Pakistan's not going to be able to handle that investment. This is another 1320 megawatt power plant. So I had the opportunity to visit all of these power plants. This is at Port Qasim in Karachi. It's a joint venture between Power China, a huge Chinese state-owned enterprise, and Al Mirkab Capital, which is a Qatari venture capital fund. Again, 1320 megawatts. This is based on imported coal as well. This took a little longer than the Sahiwal coal power plant. I think it was built in two and a half years. Rate of return. As I showed you, the rate of return is extremely high. And one of the assertions is that, this is exploitative as far as developing countries are concerned. Because the government guarantees everything, so even if the money is not on the government's balance sheets, at the end of the day, the government is actually guaranteeing that you're going to be paid everything. This criticism, I think, is a little misplaced. Because it was the geniuses at the World Bank who actually came up with these models initially. So interestingly enough, the Chinese are basically taking that model that was introduced in the 1990s and taking advantage of the rules of the game as were set in the 1990s, and no one's been able to change those rules of the game. So basically, the rate of return that you get is as follows. And it's depending on the kind of technology that you use. An IRR-based return on equity basically means, because the life of these projects is over 30 years, so when you sort of use time value of money and bring it to year zero, the return on equity that you get is 17% for imported coal, 18% for thermal coal, and then it's for other sources as well. And the rates of return are among the highest in the world. And this is, they make limited sense as far as a developing country like Pakistan is concerned, especially in the case of thermal coal, where you initially started off with rates of return, dollar index, please remember, rates of return of around 20-odd%. You did not go through a competitive bidding process, which meant that basically you did not find, you did not discover the true cost of electricity. So basically, there's no incentive for a potential investor to actually keep costs down, right? Because you're basically saying that I'll cover your costs and basically I'll give you something on top of that cost as well. So there are all of these problems. And at first glance, it does appear like, these returns are exorbitantly high. However, there are problems in the way that NEPRA, calculates this tariff as well. For example, some of the basic assumptions that are taken are extremely problematic. They use the risk-free rate of return from the US utilities, which makes absolutely no sense at all in terms of Pakistan's institutional environment. There are historic problems as far as implementation of arbitration cases is concerned. The government of Pakistan has a dismal history of implementing a lot of these arbitration cases against them. The IPPs have actually invoked their sovereign guarantees four times since 2010. And Pakistan defaulted on payments in 2012. There's a convertibility risk as well. Is there enough foreign exchange actually available in the market for you to convert your rupees into dollars? And there's an operational risk as well. So even if the government says that I'm going to give you Karachi interbank rate plus 2%, you actually need money to buy coal to run the power plant as well. So all of these risks are there. And Collier, in his study on the African power sectors, actually saw that most of the risk in these projects is actually political. And this is the case in Pakistan as well, where a lot of the risk comes from the political factors. Now, what's happened over the last 5 years is that you've been able to change the power mix. So unlike your dependence on imported oil, you switch to imported coal. So it's not optimal, but still it's cheaper as compared to imported oil. And you've also had capacity come online, which uses indigenous resources as well. The problem over here is that over the last year and a half, the Pakistani currency has depreciated by almost 50%. So your cost of generation, your actual cost of generation, whatever the fuel for generation might be, has gone up substantially because everything is indexed to the dollar. And what that does, I'll talk about what that does is. And as I said, local capital is a part of the power sector. So one of the criticisms, again, about Chinese investment is that they want to go it alone. That's not the case as far as Pakistan is concerned. In Pakistan, especially in the development of thermal coal, local capital is very much a partner of the Chinese state-owned enterprises. And there are benefits to having local capital as a partner as well. Because they understand the market, they can deal with some of the constraints. As far as working capital, et cetera, is concerned. They're used to dealing with the uncertainties of the system. That this was the only way. So, for example, when I talked to the head of one of the largest conglomerates in Pakistan who've invested now in coal-based technology, they were upfront. They were like, we went to the IFC. The IFC said no. Everyone does not want to invest in coal because of obvious reasons. I'm not saying you should. But if you look at it in the context of Pakistan, where you had such huge power shortages, coal was the best or the easiest way forward, just as thermal generation was the easiest way forward 20, 30 years ago. And this move, as I said, so I keep talking about thermal coal. So basically, Thar is this area in Sindh province in Pakistan where they discovered huge reserves of lignite-based coal. I won't bore you with the details, but lignite is the lowest quality coal of them all, which means that the moisture content is very high. So therefore, the efficiency of these plants is lower. However, there is a massive 175 billion tons of coal in this area in Sindh province. And the Pakistanis have been trying to develop these resources at least since the 1990s. Engro, which is the local conglomerate, they became involved in the project in 2008. And as I said, you know, the Chinese were the only ones who were interested in funding. And the Block 2, which is, so it's been divided into various blocks. Block 2 is the one that's actually started working. This is, it's a rare, you know, sort of success story as far as public-private partnerships are concerned. And the, it's a very interesting model that's been used over here. So basically, you've got a company which has three shareholders. One is the government of Sindh, which is the majority shareholder. The second is local conglomerates and local banks. And the third is a Chinese state-owned enterprise. What is interesting in this model is that the Chinese state-owned enterprise, which is China Machinery Engineering Corporation, is also the EPC contractor of the firm. So it's, so they're both doing the upstream work as well as being equity partners. And when I asked them why they went for such a model, they said that they wanted someone in the, with skin in the game. So they didn't want someone with who did the EPC contractor and just left. They wanted someone who was long-term in the game and who had skin in the game. So it started operating in 2018 with 3.8 million tons, and it's going to go up to around 10 million tons with total generation capacity of 1320 megawatt. The first power plant started operating in 2019 as well. What is interesting over here is that there's been this assertion that it's only the Chinese only go for capital equipment which is manufactured by Chinese firms. Over here, we see that the boiler was actually manufactured by GE. So GE isn't a Chinese firm last time I checked. So that's something that's different. And across Thar coal power plants, the technology that they're using is actually GE technology. It's not Chinese firms that have given the technology. And it's actually the case in imported coal as well. So in one of the plants, the client actually said, you know, we want GE technology, so therefore they actually got that. So it's not predominantly, it is Chinese, capital goods equipment. However, that's not the case across the board. But the choice of technology has been criticized. So this is Thar coal, basically. This is the mine. It's an open pit mine. This is just the first phase. They're basically going to go south to expand the mine, and that's going to take it up to 7.6 million tons. These are other power plants that are actually being built in the Thar Parkar area as well. And as I said, the Sindh government has actually done a wonderful job of developing the infrastructure around Thar. So for those of you who know Pakistan, Thar is one of the most deprived areas in Pakistan. The Sindh government actually spent a lot of money in developing the provincial road network connecting Thar with the province as well. And it's a wonderful, sort of road to travel on. And the question now becomes, is all of this sustainable? So is the amount of money that China is pouring into this, into the power sector, sustainable? It is a lot of money, so it's dealt with the short-term problems, which means that you don't have power shortages, you don't have power riots anymore that the Pakistan People's Party government had to deal with in 2012. But there are structural issues that remain in the sector. For example, circular debt that I talked about earlier, that stands at around $10.6 billion. So that's the amount of money that's caught up in the system, which the state does not have the capacity to actually pay back. And that has a ripple effect across the value chain. So basically, you don't get paid as a distributor, as a generator, which means that you can't pay your suppliers, which then, has other issues as well. The devaluation of the Pakistani currency has further raised. As I said, everything is indexed to the US dollar. So when the Pakistani currency is devalued, basically your cost of generation, whatever generation you're doing, is going to go up. And managing cash flows remains a problem. For example, the two power plants that I showed you earlier that came online within, 2 or 3 years, when I interviewed those guys, they had not been paid for 5 months. And the Pakistani government actually said, we're going to set up a revolving fund for you guys and we're going to pay you off as soon as possible. However, they've not been able to pay them off. They weren't able to pay them off for 5 months. And it's interesting what a senior executive at one of these power plants actually said. We would not have invested in Pakistan if it were not for the BRI and the focus of the Chinese government on the country. So that shows you the sentiment of a lot of these Chinese firms that are facing these problems. And as I said, the Chinese twice raised this issue at the JCC, which is supposed to be the highest forum of negotiation, that, you know, we need to make sure that our firms are actually paid on time. However, the government just does not have the resources to actually pay them on time. It's just as simple as that. And the problem is likely to become more acute as you have more capacity that comes online. So during 2020, there are a number of other power plants that are going to come online. 2021, there are hydro projects that are going to come online. Similar is the case in 2022. However, I don't think that the Chinese are going to call in the sovereign guarantees because they know the Pakistanis don't have the capacity to pay. And the quote from this executive at the Chinese firm is actually interesting. So, for example, the Chinese investment in the sector is patient capital, right? So as state-owned enterprises, they've got a dual motive. It's not only to make money, but it's also to further whatever interests there are of the central government. And there's a lot of literature on how state-owned enterprises actually have a profit motive as well. But the profit, they do not deny the fact that there is a profit motive. However, there's a broader national imperative involved as well. So it's unlikely that Chinese firms are going to, sort of call in the sovereign guarantees. The other problem is that there's a lack of local participation. So 22 months, as I said to you earlier, there's no Pakistani firm that works in the civil engineering, sort of broad area that can meet those sort of deliverables. So what that has meant is that initially in the early harvest phase, in the first two projects, you've got extremely limited money that's gone into the local economy. Most of the money has actually gone back to China because all the EPC contracts were from there. As I said, even the chandelier, the floor, etc., they'd all been imported. In the Saival case, they actually subcontracted the work to a large local firm. The large local firm just wasn't able to, meet the quality requirements of these SOEs or meet the time requirements of these SOEs as well. So it's not like the Chinese don't want to spend any money locally. It's just that the capacity for many of these firms isn't there. And at the end of the day, in a lot of these cases, what we've seen in other cases of successful technology diffusion is that the state has to take an active role, right? So the state has to force the foreign investor to actually invest in building certain technological capabilities in the local economy. There's a lot of literature on that. There is no way that the Pakistani state is going to do that. It just does not have the capability or the capacity to actually talk to investors and force them to actually invest in this technology transfer. And there have been political challenges as well. As I said, so a lot of this investment came in during Pakistan Muslim League's rule, which was from 2013 to 2018. Political changes have actually soured the mood as far as CPEC investments in the energy sector are concerned. And one of the problems is that a lot of the things that were handled in-house during negotiations, they are now being done, on the media. And that's something that the Chinese just do not like. For example, this one power project, which was in Rahimyar Khan on imported coal, was cancelled. So that's fine. As I said, that's something that's been ongoing as far as CPEC is concerned. It's a moving target. So, you have some projects that are added to the list and there are others that are cancelled. However, in this particular case, it actually came on the media and there was a lot of, hue and cry as far as the Pakistani media was concerned. And the literature actually suggests that in previous instances, the dispute resolution mechanisms have been more of a government-to-government discussion as opposed to taking it out on the media. And this is something which did not, sit well with the Chinese. The second area that I talked about is transport infrastructure. And that's, in order to build the corridor, you need roads, you need pipelines, you need you need railway lines to actually connect Kashgar all the way to Pakistan. And basically, the World Bank actually says that transport infrastructure or improvements in Pakistan's transport infrastructure can actually have a major impact as far as real incomes are concerned. However, over here, a lot of the domestic policymakers and their priorities actually come to the fore. So there's a local political economy aspect that comes into the investment in the transport sector. And a lot of the investments that were made needed to ensure that they were in sync with the requirements of the local political economy. They also were needed to be, so the Chinese actually did a monographic study on the transport infrastructure sector from 2014 all the way to 2030. And basically, the idea of that monographic study was to develop the transport infrastructure in a more scientific manner. So basically, what they say is that you need multimodal connections between Kashgar, Islamabad, Sakhar, Karachi, Gwadar. And this is the initial, version of that transport report. It was later changed, amended by the Pakistanis. But interestingly enough, it completely bypasses Balochistan. So Gwadar port is in Balochistan. I'm sorry, I don't have maps. I should have had maps over here. But it completely bypasses the rest of Balochistan and goes straight to Gwadar. And Gwadar is the pivot around which, CPEC revolves. As I said, you needed to connect to the western region. And the basic idea behind building roads is that if you want to get rich, you basically need to build a road first. So when you solve that supply-side bottleneck as far as transport infrastructure is concerned, economic activity is going to follow. That's the rationale. And basically, the idea behind the road transport network was that you had one corridor and multiple alignments. And the multiple alignments are western, central, and eastern alignments. However, unlike energy, where a lot of money has actually come in terms of infrastructure, the amount of money that's come in developing the road network, which one would have thought would have been quite substantial, is quite limited. There are only two road projects that have actually been almost completed. One is complete, the other is almost going to be completed, with a total outlay of around $4.5 billion. And one of them is the Karachi-Lahore motorway, and one section of that motorway is Multan to Sakhar. There's another motorway that's going to be built from Sakhar to Hyderabad in order to link Karachi to Lahore. However, that motorway has not been built. So the initial idea was that during the time that you had the Lahore-Sakhar-Multan-Sakhar motorway being built, you would also start work on the Sakhar-Hyderabad part of the motorway to ensure that you had connectivity between Lahore and Karachi. That's not actually happened, and we can, of course, talk about why that's not happened during the question and answer section. This is pictures from the motorway being actually built. The second area was railways. Now, this is actually one of the case studies that I've been looking at in greater detail, because this is a project that in 2017 was titled as a strategic project of CPEC. This main line connects Karachi all the way to Lahore and goes to Peshawar. It has a total length of 1,700 odd kilometers. And it makes a lot of economic sense because 80% of the revenue of the Pakistan Railways is actually generated on this line. There's been no progress as far as the main line one is concerned. And there is, of course, an inherent bias as far as railways is concerned within the Pakistani state. And there's a lack of policy support at the highest level. So if you look at the profile of passengers traveling on the railways, 90% actually use economy class, which is the lowest class as far as the railways is concerned. So that just gives you an idea of the profile, economic profile of passengers. And the rail, it's not like you have a state-of-the-art railway. That's the picture on the top right. That's basically you mapping where your trains are. It's all manually done. This is the state of the railway infrastructure as far as manufacturing is concerned. You've got machines which are actually from the turn of the last century, 1911, that are still working in many of these workshops. What the and I know that it's 5 minutes, so I'll try to hurry up, but I still have a lot to go. Basically, what the transport sector or investment in the transport sector has actually done is that it's stoked a lot of subnational grievances. The road network that's being built is through the heartland of the Punjab and through Sindh as well. It bypasses Balochistan completely, and that has stoked a lot of resentment as far as the smaller provinces are concerned. So as far as CPEC is concerned, there is this subnational grievance as well. The second area which is interesting to see is, as I said earlier, there's a lot of local political economy as far as the transport network is concerned. And basically, if you look at, if you use the political settlements literature, if you look at it from a political settlements, sort of a lens, powerful organizations have their own incentives to actually support or not support projects. And it's basically about rent extraction. And differences in rent extraction between various organizational interests, be they Chinese or Pakistani, lead to delay as far as the implementation of projects is concerned. Industrial cooperation, don't have a lot of time, but just to talk about industrial cooperation, basically, under CPEC, there are 9 special economic zones that are to be built, and the idea is that Chinese firms are going to invest in these special economic zones. I went to Pakistan at the end of 2018. The discourse on, or the discussion about these special economic zones started around mid-2018, and the idea was that they're going to be operational by the mid of 2019. The first special economic zones have yet to start work. The Prime Minister broke ground on one of the special economic zones in 2020, so there's no progress as far as the special economic zones are concerned. And then there's this question of whether Pakistan can actually use FDI strategically. Pakistan has had one of the most liberal foreign direct investment regimes in the world. Since the mid-1990s, you could actually own as a foreign investor, 100% of a firm, you could repatriate profit, 100% of the profit as well. And yet foreign direct investment in Pakistan has not really flowed towards efficiency, as it's called in the foreign direct investment literature, efficiency seeking, FDI in the manufacturing sector. Most of the focus has been on the service sector or on power generation and mobile communication. So then the question, and if you listen to the discourse in Islamabad, the discourse is that we're going to have joint ventures between local companies and Chinese firms. The question then becomes, what is the incentive for a Chinese firm to actually have a joint venture? Because what you're doing as far as the special economic zones is concerned is that you're providing all of the services to Chinese firms in this area, which is well protected, where you've given them X number of incentives as well. So what is the incentive for a Chinese firm to actually enter into a joint venture with a local firm, because initially all of the money that came in is state-owned enterprises. But in this second phase, you're going to have private capital come in as well. And there's a lack of policy clarity as well. Especially with the change of government, there's been a change or there's been a slowdown or there's a perception that CPEC has actually slowed down. And a senior Chinese policymaker that I talked to said, if the present government does not agree with the policy framework, it has every right to change it. However, it cannot remain ambivalent and expect investors to come in a stage of policy limbo. This will have a negative impact on FDI in the country. At present, there is a complete lack of any policy across multiple sectors of the economy, including industry, ICT, and agriculture. And then there's a problem. Go to questions. And there's a problem as far as CPEC is concerned. So basically, the way that governments have been trying to use CPEC is that they've been trying to use it as a replacement for the public sector development program. The Pakistani state is supposed to use this public sector development program to actually fund development schemes. A lot of the projects that have been pitched to the Chinese lack any commercial, logic at all. So a lot of these projects have to do with water supply, sanitation, etc. So what the Chinese have actually finally done is that they have earmarked $1 billion for socio-economic projects. I'll leave it there, won't finish the conclusion, then we can go to question and answers. Yeah.
extremely interesting. Yes, questions, contributions? Yes, over here at the front, and then over there, yeah.
So we talked about sustainability in terms of in CPEC. Does the Pakistani state recognize the...
You could just speak up a little. Yeah, great.
...the implications on the environment that the coal development has, because developing such a vast industry in coal and then also being a part of advocating, like also having a lot of environmental crises, like how does that play into each other?
Great. Should we take three or four? Yeah. And then up there.
Yeah. Hello, thank you for the presentation. I work on similar issues in Cambodia, Myanmar, which are countries that are, you know, sort of defined as China's client state. So where China, especially in the context of the Belt and Road, decides everything. Or at least that's the current narrative. And here I think you spoke of a bit of a mixed picture from lobbying from local business people, from engagement with the government, but also, for example, the lack of regulations on JVs or the lack of other potential or the use of Chinese standards in these projects, for example. So what's your view specifically on this matter, on the sort of agency in the relation with China?
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you for the presentation. It was really detailed and really nice. My question is about methodology. I think you touched it in like one line and you said that we can talk about it later. And then at the end, you talked about lack of clarity on policy. Don't you think it's all one of the reasons it could be because there is not much public documents or information available on CPAC? And also, do you think because of BRI and how it's going to be linked up, do you think there's going to be more public information available on CPAC? And last question, how did you get those documents, like as a researcher? Thank you.
Okay, this one here.
Thank you very much for the presentation. You said that you spent 9 to 10 months on the CPAC projects. That would be really kind of you if you could just highlight any labor issues that Chinese labor is actually facing in Pakistan and any kind of cooperation they're getting from the Chinese laws.
So let's start with the sustainability bit. That is a major problem, yes, as far as... So sustainability is a major issue. It had not featured initially in the discourse, and there are a couple of reasons for it. Number one was the crippling power shortage. So the idea was that, you know, this was the cheapest and the easiest way to actually get capacity going. For example, one of the power plants that I showed you is in the agricultural heartland of Punjab. And there's a lot of hue and cry about what the implications are for the environment in the long run. However, if you talk to a lot of the Chinese firms, what they say is that they followed World Bank protocols as far as, you know, ensuring that they meet all of the safety standards for coal generation are concerned. And if you talk to Pakistani policymakers, they're very candid about it. They say, you know, we cannot afford at the moment the kind of problems that we had in 2013. We cannot or we could not afford to wait for 5 years for hydel capacity to actually come online. So this was the easiest solution. But you're right, these problems are emergent in Thar, on the other hand, because there's a marginalized community as far as Thar is concerned. So the voice of that community hasn't really been heard in the same way. In Thar, because it's a desert, so and coal is water intensive. So in order for that mine that I showed you, there are 24, there are six or seven large pumps that are extracting water 24/7 just to make sure that the mine does not collapse. So what does that do to the aquifer? So these are all questions that are going to probably come to the fore as you know, this sort of progresses. But as far as the company is concerned, they say that they've done all of the due diligence as far as companies are concerned, and the depth at which they're extracting water doesn't really affect the water table as far as people use it. On the Cambodia, Myanmar, and agency bit, that's the interesting bit, actually. So for me, the railway project was the most interesting thing that I studied because on the one hand, most of the literature actually shows, you know, the Chinese come in, they put the money, they railroad everyone, and, you know, they basically get things done. But here was a project which was strategically important. That's something that they They say openly, you know, it's public news, and yet it's been 3 years. They're still under negotiation. They're not. The project hasn't been built. So what's the story over there? And my my contention is that there are two aspects to the story. One is local agency, because these actors who negotiate on the behalf of the recipient governments, they're not powerless. So these state-enabled actors, as I call them, they're not powerless. They actually have the capacity to actually negotiate with the larger power. And the Chinese are receptive to some of the things. They're, of course, not receptive to everything you say as a host government. But they're receptive to some of the points. For example, after these initial power plants, the host government said, you know, we want local sourcing to be a part of the project. They're like, okay, you know, if those firms meet our requirements, we can go up to like 30% of the total contract, EPC contract. The second, manifestation of agency is through the local political economy, because a lot of the discourse around the Belt and Road Initiative and on CPEC in particular, discounts the local political economy, which is not the case, because there are some extremely strong organizational interests that are linked as far as the transportation sector are concerned, both in the private sector as well as in the public sector. So making sure that you can get these projects off the ground without antagonizing these interests and coming to a rent-sharing agreement, you know, on a rent, not in the sort of corruption rent, but rent-sharing agreement in terms of the EPC contract, for example, is something that Chinese firms will probably have to do. It's probably going to be the same case in Myanmar and Cambodia as well, but that's the two-faced, you know, sort of manifestation of local agency that one finds in a lot of these projects. Methodology. So methodologically, I went for a lot of, as I said, elite interviews. So in-depth interviews with people who were actually involved in the negotiation process, with firms that were a part of this early stage of CPEC, with policymakers, especially politicians who were involved in a lot of these negotiations. So that's the way that I did it. And it was open-ended interviews, basically, you know, just trying to get as much information about this particular project as depending on who the person is. For example, when I went to Thar, I talked to a lot of the company executives about where the project was, where it's moving, how it's gone off the ground, how the EPC contractor was selected, you know, those sort of things. As far as the lack of information is concerned, yes, there is a lack of information, and I think the Chinese embassy is now trying to, you know, there was a report today as well, that the Chinese embassy is now trying to, you know, sort of deal with a lot of these issues. What they've done, most interestingly, is that, back in the early 2000s, no one knew the name of the Chinese ambassador in Pakistan, right? Everyone knew the name of the U.S. ambassador. Things have flipped so quickly. Everyone knows the name of the Chinese ambassador in Pakistan. No one knows, I don't know the name of the American ambassador. So that just shows you the importance of the Chinese. And what they've been very good at doing is this whole projection of soft power. The media outreach of the Chinese over the last couple of years has been substantial. You know, they've developed their own, areas of patronage within the media as well. There's a whole discourse around it on Twitter. There's this one fascinating character. His name was Li Jianqiao. I don't know if you guys know of him or not. Li Jianqiao was the deputy head of mission in the Chinese embassy. Prolific on Twitter. And he would take American, policy people on Twitter head on. And he's now gone back to China now, and he's head of PR or something of that sort in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Now, every ambassador, a Chinese ambassador in various parts of the world is on Twitter, getting the message across, their own narrative across. So that's the kind of change that I've seen as far as, creating a public discourse is concerned. Getting the information, that was tough. I mean, 9-10 months going again and again and again. So one has to be extremely persistent as far as, these things are concerned. Labor issues, as far as Chinese labor, you particularly asked about Chinese labor. So in the case of Sahiwal, because it had to be built in 22 months, Chinese laborers basically had no place to stay. You know, they basically lived in containers. The kind of food they had was local. The areas that they lived in were extremely rudimentary. But I haven't really come across any indication, if that's what you're asking, that there were prisoners or anything of that sort. It wasn't. I at least have not come across any evidence at all that the Chinese labor in a lot of these camps were prisoners. They were employees of the Chinese state-owned enterprises or the EPC contractors that actually built these projects. There was a lot of talk about these LNG plants as well, that, you know, there's prisoner labor that's been used. I have no indication of that sort.
Okay. So one at the back, two at the back. And two over here. Yeah.
Okay. Yes. Hi. I did my PhD on the Third Coal Project, and So these are perhaps more comments than, but I obviously didn't interact with the Chinese. I spent quite a lot of time within the communities, and the Third Coal wasn't CPEC. Then it became CPEC when I was there, and I left. But one of the things I found was when it became CPEC, it became very securitized. The Pakistan Army came. The Chinese engineers, when they would go, or there would be military convoys. And what the Chinese were, I mean, it'd be interesting to find out from you, is of course you have this continual Hindu-Muslim tension in Pakistan, the communal tension, which Mr. Modi is now trying to exploit. But I mean, the tension is there. Well, whatever Modi is doing in India that doesn't come from a vacuum. There's Hindu-Muslim tension, particularly in southern Sindh. I mean, are the Chinese aware of this? I mean, as they plan, because they are obviously, as I was leaving, the Chinese influence, you started to see Chinese in these very securitized, fortified places. Are they aware of the sort of terrain that they're coming to, in terms of, for example, the Hindu-Muslim tensions in Pakistan, the communal politics, the marginal status of Tabarkar, and generally with extractive industry, locals don't really benefit from it. You know, they just don't have the technical skills, to be honest. I was just more of the question was what are the Chinese, and that would probably apply for Balochistan as well. Right. Thank you.
Hello. My question's on you mentioned the power station that was built in 22 months, which is not just for Pakistan, that's incredibly quick. And presumably it was cheap because the Chinese have funded it. So if it's obviously in their interest to make it cheap. So my question is, has there been any kind of safety assessment either independently or nationally by the Pakistani government? Because there could be an accident where it explodes. And also take into account what you said about the labour, the quality of the labour that was there building these works. And also it's key infrastructure. I mean, so there's the economic aspect and then the pure safety aspect.
Great. At the back and then the front, yeah.
So it's already been partly mentioned, but so the situation in Balochistan is pretty
and then just at the front here.
Do you sense that at the bottom line there's been a failure on the part of Pakistan to be on top of the game? And the second issue is it's disappointing that there hasn't been any technology transfer fallout, given that it's a problem that China well understands and has always been pretty much on top of.
Okay, and then, okay, maybe over there, and then we can, and we'll take you in the next round.
There has been a discourse that all these agreements were hastily made, lack of due diligence, lack of taking provincial interest into harmony. one wonders what could have been done differently to address these objections. Because if a major, rather substantial portion of investment is going into Gwadar, it is not an economic project. So it is bringing a major share to Balochistan. So do you think that there were alternates available at that time or now which could have addressed such objections, or there are just part of political contestation?
Okay. Yeah, do you want to, sorry, we'll take you and then you afterwards, yeah.
So on the sudden Sindh and the Hindu-Muslim question, I would humbly beg to disagree a little bit, because Thar is one of those parts of Pakistan where you actually had better communal harmony as compared to many other places. So if you look at the social fabric of Thar, there wasn't the same sort of problems, you know, as far as communal tensions concerned. That's probably going to change, and the reason for that is that there's going to be lots and lots of people who are going to come in from outside who are going to change the fabric of the way that Thar is actually structured. So it's going to change the way that it's already changed the value of land. The value of land was completely different because, you know, you had pastoralist communities which sort of moved around. Now with such massive amounts of money coming in, the value of land has completely changed. The way of life of a lot of these people has actually changed. So when I was in Thar, Engros developed this new society with paved roads for people who were affected by the mine that I showed you earlier. And that was very different from the kind of living that I mean, it was brick houses, don't get me wrong, but it was very different from the kind of houses where local Thar people actually lived. So there is going to be a change in the way that people's lives actually are structured. I don't think the Chinese care about that. Why would they care about that? It's the local government that actually has to care about that. No one from outside, they're there to make money. It's a transactional, you know, sort of a relationship. Paak Chin Dosti on one side, but it's a transactional relationship. So it's the local government that actually has to ensure that it meets whatever requirements there are of the local people. And the way that it was structured, I mean, because you were there initially, at least Block 2, and I'm only talking about Block 2 at the moment, was that they wanted to make sure that local people were a part of the way that it evolved, right? Shamsuddin Sheikh, at least initially, you know, came to the media and, you know, so said, you know, locals have to be a part of that. And they've done all of these corporate social responsibility, 2% of the revenue has to go towards local people. You know, we're training local people to actually become drivers, et cetera, et cetera. So they're trying to do that. But at the end of the day, the truth is that it's a marginalized part of the country. It's a marginalized part of the population, both Muslim and Hindu. I don't think if you put the communal side to angle to one side as well, there is going to be a massive change as far as their life is concerned. On the security, that's a very interesting point that you raise, because one of the problems that Chinese face is that they're not able to move around freely in the country, right? So the people that I talked to basically moved around with what's that called, the special security force that they've developed with those guys with them. And that's a major problem. So basically what they say is that, you know, it's almost like we're in prison. It's not our idea of fun. It's not a holiday for us. It's not our ideal posting, right? So that's one of the concerns. And going forward, if you want to get in, you know, private investment into the country, that's going to be a problem. How do you ensure that these people actually have a standard of living? On the safety assessment, maybe it came out wrongly, but a lot of the labor that these Chinese companies brought in is skilled labor. So that's the problem that they had. So initially, because they wanted to build these power plants quickly, they brought a lot of skilled labor over from China. So the cost of skilled labor, the cost of Chinese labor across the board is going to be higher as compared to Pakistani labor. So that's one of the reasons that they had to bring in a lot of people. The living conditions initially when they were doing because they did a survey of the project as well. So they did have all of these issues as far as living conditions were concerned. But the Pakistani government, at the end of the day, whenever a plant comes online, there is an assessment that goes through. How rigorous that assessment is, I can't answer that question, but there is an assessment that actually goes in. They also have third-party inspectors come in and look at those facilities as well. And of course, the Chinese have experience of building infrastructure quite quickly, but you're right to say that 22 months is insane. You know, building something in 22 months, a 1320 megawatt power plant, is no joke. Balochistan and the Chinese, the Chinese dimension, they understand it, and there's been some sort of moves to make sure that the Baloch feel that they're a part of the process as well. For example, the Chinese embassy took Baloch notables all the way to Beijing. They went to a number of cities as well. So there's that sort of, rapprochement that's going on between the Chinese and the Baloch. And through the JCC and those sort of things, there's an ongoing, sort of dialogue, at least on the face of it, between the local Baloch politicians and the Chinese company. So before this, Gawada used to be with Port Singapore, the Singaporean Port Authority, and basically it was moribund. So the Chinese say, we poured all of this money in, we're trying to, develop the local economy, we're trying to make sure that local Baloch youth have employment, so all of the, the optics, as I said, the optics around it is extremely important. So they're trying to deal with that, and do understand the security problems, of course. I mean, they're not averse to it. The Pakistani state, so what they did was that in order to protect a lot of these projects, at least in the Punjab and in KPK, what they did was they raised a division of the Pakistan Army. So it's called the Special Protection Group, SPD, or something of that sort. And it's headed by a major general. So now what they're doing is that because there's going to be more activity probably towards the south of the country, there's going to be another division that's going to be raised. So that's the way that they're trying to deal with this security. So it's around 10,000 odd people with 5,000, 6,000 soldiers, 4,000 police personnel. So that's the way that they're trying to deal with the security problem. Failure to get on the top of things. Yes and no. So again, if one thinks about the kind of politics in Pakistan from 2014 all the way through to 2018 and the kind of pressures that the elected government was going through, it's amazing that they actually got this done. I do think that had the pressures been lesser from other sources, probably it would have been, at least in the Punjab, so I'm there's a caveat attached, at least in the Punjab they would have done more. Because they wanted to, so Punjab is the only place, for example, where Chinese firms, private firms, have actually invested around $40 odd billion, sorry, in setting up industries in Faisalabad. So at least till Punjab, they would have been able to do much more. The problem is structural. So the things that I was talking about FDI, about transfer of technology, those sort of things, they're structural. The Pakistani state, be it the political class, the military, whoever is in power, it's not a part of their decision calculus because it doesn't matter politically for them. Transfer of technology is important when you think about it in terms of a state, a developmental state, for example, South Korea or even Cambodia to that extent, to some extent. But in the Pakistani state, it's only the discourse because the underlying institutional structure, which is giving 100% equity stake to a foreign investor, it hasn't changed. It was the same under the PPP's government, it was the same under PMLN's government, it was the same under Musharraf's government, and lo and behold, it's the same under PTI. So it's just that, there's no returns to actually having this sort of a policy. So due diligence and whether these things have been hasty, on the power side of it, the PMLN came in government on the promise of actually dealing with the power shortage. They dealt with it,
My question is, there is a very dark cloud of accusations and finger pointing. What alternately could have been done, either at a later state or by the new government?
As far as CPEC is concerned, about corruption and those sort of things.
Chinese
investments. See, at the end of the day, they're a part of. So, for example, Alice Wells. I went to Washington to that that conference where she actually said that, you know, CPEC is a debt trap, etc., etc., etc. See, at the end of the day, the Pakistani state had no choice. There are no people aren't really queuing up to invest in Pakistan. So this is the best of I mean, if you want to put it that way, this is the best of a lot of bad choices that you had. And then, as I said, the Pakistani state, is very powerful in certain things, but in many other things, it doesn't really have the sort of state capacity that is required for effecting, you know, structural change in the economy or those sort of things. This is the only choice that they actually had.
Okay. So we've got you, and then, oh, you've got the mic. Okay. Yeah. You go first, and then you. Yeah.
Okay, thanks. If I've been listening correctly, I think you've been portraying a sort of bit of a contrast between the very rapid investment in energy, which was a domestic political priority, if I've understood you, and a much slower move on the road and rail infrastructure. Is that primarily because you had the ability to leverage or attract the state-owned enterprise investment into energy, and there's not an equivalent mechanism in roads, or is it there's extra security challenges around roads? I just wonder if you could shed a bit more light on that sort of contrast.
Thanks for your great presentations. I just have very simple questions for you that I'm just wondering that what attitudes for just like, because Chinese government also put great importance on just like bilateral relationship, we said we have very good relationship, just like friendship, everything. But I'm just wondering, what's the change before, after the CPEC? The ordinary people, ordinary Pakistanis, because I guess that maybe the ordinary people or government officials or allies or just like academias have different attitudes towards the CPEC. So I just want to know what's the difference between the after the CPEC carried out in Pakistan, because as far as I know, you just did your fieldwork more than 10 months in Pakistan. So this is my question. And another one is that, so I know that there are a lot of challenges ahead of us, but do you have any kind of predictions for the CPEC? And you also just mentioned that, the lack of the local participation, that's also really a problem. So do you have any proposals for that, how to deal with that problem of lacking of the local participation for the CPEC? Thank you.
Good questions. So, yes, go ahead.
So very much related to the first question. I assume that the Chinese government must have a huge interest in the roads and the railways starting to work, because that's how the economic benefit is going to be created. So is there a shift in the pressure that the Chinese government is exercising on Pakistani officials to actually get the railroads and roads created? Yeah.
Great. Over here. Just to your right.
Thanks. Thanks very much. You mentioned the socioeconomic fund, I think, that's come into being, I think partly in response to some critique. So I just wondered if you could say a little bit more about what that's for and how it's being spent. Also, I understood that the sort of the broader Belt and Roads Initiative has a cultural strand to it. So, you say. So I wondered, is there one to this element, and if so, what is it, and what are its pros and cons? And then lastly, you mentioned that there's very little interest in, from the Chinese perspective, I think, you said, to deal with this huge change that's going to happen to life as a result of the power and road developments, and that's seen as the responsibility of local government. And if that's the case, then what are they doing to prepare and support that change to be a positive change? seeing as they seem presumed they want to change, and that's why it's happening. Thank you.
Thanks. So we take a last sort of two or three questions. Yeah, over here.
My question is, do you see the possibility of Pakistani people accept the, you mentioned the SPE, right? And do you think it's possible for Pakistani to accept the model of SPE development in China? Or can China transport the model of SPE development in Pakistan? And the second question is, you mentioned the lack of local participation, right? And do you think language plays a role in this problem? Okay, that's fine.
Thanks. Yeah, one at the back.
You mentioned Alice Wells. So just taking the discussion sort of slightly above the what's actually the action on the ground, I mean, sort of the US or the wider sort of perceptions or view, geostrategic aspects of CPEC. I mean, what would be the, I suppose, the mechanism? Because at the moment it's very much, okay, look, this is a debt trap, you know, sort of caveat emptor, be warned. But, I mean, behind the scenes, whatever, what would be the mechanism if, for instance, there were serious, serious geopolitical kind of considerations that, like the U.S., could employ to affect change in the way CPEC is currently structured or organized. But just if you could comment on that.
Okay. Anyone else? Those are all excellent questions. Okay. Right. Just some answers and then any concluding remarks you want to make.
The other one is, I guess, with what's happened since the 5th of August, and there's a bit of a shift in the sort of narrative on the Indian side that, look, we're talking about PAK-occupied Kashmir and kind of a lot of infrastructure being developed here. So what do you see as having changed as a result of that change on this side? That, does that make sense?
So I'll start off with the last one first. So behind the scenes, you know, there's a lot going on, of course, with Afghanistan. So this is not my area of expertise, so whatever I'm going to say is going to be a layman's, layperson's view. But there's a lot that's going on behind the scene, you know, the US-Pakistan rapprochement, and especially over Afghanistan and all. And then Alice Wells, which is what is most interesting about Alice Wells is that she said it in Washington and then she said it in Islamabad as well. And in the statement that she made in Washington, the response from the Pakistanis was quite swift. What she said in Islamabad, the response actually came from the Chinese embassy first and then was followed by the Pakistanis. So that's actually interesting for me when I look at it as a student of Pakistan-China relations. Frankly speaking, I don't think that the U.S. is going to have a major problem as far as these things are concerned. Because at the end of the day, the idea would be that there's some sort of stability as far as the economy is concerned as well. Especially if this second phase, you know, sort of goes through, or half-cooked goes through. One of the things that I didn't talk about was the China-Pakistan Free Trade Agreement Part 2. It's just, sort of been negotiated and come in force. And the Chinese are actually giving tariff-free access to a lot of Pakistani products, which before this had substantial tariffs. So that can, you know, sort of start, kickstart this process of exports and, you know, industrial development of that sort.
The way I read it, it looked like just purely agricultural.
No, it's manufacturing as well. So if there's a new study that's just come out, so Some of the projects that Pakistan exports, I mean, it's not like Pakistan has a very vast export basket, but some of the manufacturers, especially textiles, where before you couldn't compete with places like Bangladesh, now the tariff levels have been brought down that you can actually compete with Bangladesh. And I do think that, you know, there are Chinese firms that are going to relocate to Pakistan, probably not to the extent that the Pakistanis would like it to happen, but there is going to be some sort of relocation just because of the fact that the Pakistani market is substantial and the cost of manufacturing for export industries is lower as well. So I think that the posturing is going to go through in the larger, you know, sort of scheme of the Belt and Road Initiative and on CPEC, and there's going to be these statements from Washington, but I don't think that the Washington is going to be very bothered about, you know, the way things are moving. They might be bothered if things move too much towards that side, but see, at the end of the day, the Pakistani elite still speak English. They still go to British or US universities. The Pakistani armed forces, frankly speaking, would still want to go to Sandhurst or to the US for training as opposed to, you know, going to PLA facilities in China. They would still want to buy US weaponry. So, you know, when one looks at it in that sort of a scenario, then I don't think that it's going to be, there's going to be posturing in the broader, you know, sort of Belt and Road Initiative. I don't think it's going to be massive. On the Pakistan occupied Kashmir, and that's very interesting. So one of the books that's just come out is Siegfried Wolf. He's based in Berlin. And he says that a lot of the infrastructure that is being built on in Gilgit-Baltistan is actually illegal. Because this is not Pakistan, this is actually land which is disputed. Again, I mean, if better sense prevails, I don't think that there's going to be a massive, you know, sort of change as far as India is going to continue to oppose the building of this, of the infrastructure. If things go south in a major way, then there might be, you know, sort of the specter of conflict, but I don't really think that they're going to go south majorly. If there's a protracted slowdown in India, you know, with the kind of things that are going on, maybe, but I don't really see that beyond, you know, skirmishes on in terms of words. I don't think it's going to go further than that. Socioeconomic culture, actually, I'll come to culture first, because that's actually interesting. What's interesting is that China has 20,000, they've given scholarships to 20,000 Pakistani students to now study in Chinese universities. So these students, so it's almost like a evening or a Fulbright program that the Chinese are now sponsoring. These 20,000 people now know Chinese, of course, because you can't live in China without really speaking Chinese. They have a better understanding of the culture, of the cultural nuances of China, and despite these, you know, sort of things about Pakistan and China being very close, culturally they've not really understood each other very well. Similarly, in terms of education, there's going to be further expansion. There's going to be expansion in terms of technical and vocational education. There's going to be expansion in terms of China investing or giving grants to NGOs to develop education. Hospitals, those sort of things in agriculture as well. So it's quite wide-ranging, this $1 billion socioeconomic, you know, sort of funding that they want to do. Whether it makes sense in the long run for a country like Pakistan, which has had massive, you know, sort of injections of this sort of funding before, is another story altogether, because I don't think that having these sort of handouts does anything positive for the productive side of the economy, because it creates a lot of perverse incentives on the other sides as well. Life-changing as far as these power projects are concerned. So there are two sides of this. So this in Thar, at least, this company which is developing one of the blocks that I showed you, the one that I visited. So they have all of these health projects. They have you know, vocational training institutes as well. They have education. They're trying to improve water supply for a lot of these people as well. They've built houses, as I said, for these people, you know, trying to ensure that they're in sync with their cultural nuances. But their life is going to change, because these are semi-nomadic pastoralist, you know, sort of communities who moved from one place to the other depending on land. Free movement is going to be a problem. Because now you have these massive power plants coming, you can't really, you know, sort of have your camels or your goats and, you know, take them to the power plants. Environmentally, water-wise, how things evolve, that remains to be seen. But at least in terms of some sort of an action, which is probably better than what's happened in many other places, there is some sort of action over there. Okay. In terms of the huge interest in the road and rail network, yes, there is. There is substantial interest. The Chinese want it done. There's a macroeconomic picture as well, because Pakistan has substantial balance of payments. So we've gone back, or Pakistan's gone back to the IMF for the 13th time in the last, 20-odd years. So there's that aspect as well. It's not only the local political economy. It's about if you take on these loans, the IMF has reservations on whether you can take on these loans on your balance sheet. And the Chinese have been very clear, if you look at some of the documents, the Chinese have been very clear that they do not want to fund these projects, because for them, the returns don't make sense. So that's one aspect of it. The second, it was easier in power because you made money out of it, right? So if you even if it's delayed, you're going to make some money out of it. And I do think, you know, there's this discourse about how, you know, there's no due diligence, the Chinese aren't going to make money out of it. These Chinese state-owned enterprises, as well as their Pakistani partners, are going to make it. It's going to be delayed, and it's going to be problematic, as we've seen in the case of Pakistan's power industry, but they are going to make returns. Once Pakistan exits from the IMF program, or near exit, as the political compulsions for the government increase, we will probably see a spurt in terms of infrastructure funding. But at the moment, you know, the macroeconomic picture doesn't really allow it as well. On the bilateral relationship and how ordinary Pakistanis actually perceive China, as I said, it's only now that there are lots of Chinese people who are now coming to Pakistan. So it's the first sort of major cultural sort of interaction that's taking place between people in the two countries. And there are problems, right? For example, in a lot of these power plants, the engineers are all Pakistanis. The Chinese way of working is very, very different from the way that Pakistanis are trained or Pakistani engineers are trained. So getting in sync with the way that they work is proving to be problematic, but because they've now spent 2-3 years working for these firms, so now, you know, they're more comfortable in working with a lot of these state-owned enterprises. On the ground, there is still positive sentiment, but there are, as two communities have, or two peoples interact, there are, of course, going to be problems. So in 2019, there was this whole scandal of Pakistani brides for sale in China. And that had, you know, that's created this this negative sort of a perception. But overwhelmingly, you know, if you talk to people, there is still, you know, the notion is that China is the only friend that Pakistan has had. You know, they've stood with us through thick and thin. That's the notion that people have. The elite is a different story. The elite, as I said earlier as well, is more Western-oriented. And if you talk to a lot of people, you know, the perception of the elite about Chinese or Chinese investment is probably more negative as compared to the perception on the ground. So the elite is a different story as far as Pakistanis are concerned. Predictions as far as local participation, I think it's going to increase, especially if, as I said, industries relocate. It makes business sense to have local labor, right? You know, what sort of long-term positive dividends that has for the Pakistani economy remains to be seen, because in terms of developing linkages with the local economy, you know, there are questions about whether that can happen without an activist state. And as I've said earlier, Pakistan does not have an activist state. So ensuring that you do not have islands of efficiency in industry is going to be important. And I've already answered the rail infrastructure. Just the final point on Gwadar, actually. Gwadar is interesting. Because Gwadar, when I went to Gwadar in April 2019, there was basically, the port was operational. There was nothing, apart from the port, there was nothing in Gawadar. Over the last 7 to 8 months, what's happened is that you have the infrastructure, the road infrastructure is now being built. The power plant, which will supply Gawadar City, is now being built. The master plan, which has been designed by China Communications CCCC, has been almost approved. The work on the new Gawadar International Airport is ongoing. It's probably going to be completed in the next couple of years. So you have all the trappings of an international city, which can emerge as an enclave economy. And that's the danger. So if you have this enclave economy, and by the way, new Gawadar International Airport is going to be the largest airport in Pakistan. So you have all the trappings of an enclave economy, and how you take advantage of these opportunities remains to be seen, because it is an opportunity, but you have all the trappings of an enclave economy being developed right in front of us. And if the Chinese are intelligent, and the Chinese are extremely intelligent, they would actively try and ensure that sort of a perception does not become reality, or that perception is actively countered, because that's extremely problematic as far as Balochistan's political economy is concerned, but the wider political economy in Pakistan is concerned as well.
Okay, join me in thanking Tayyip. Next week's seminar is Techno-Humanitarianism, Rethinking the Securitization and Victimization of Refugees, with Martina Tazzioli from Goldsmiths. So join us next week. And also, everyone's warmly welcome to a reception upstairs in the Senior Common Room. Thank you.